Okay, we're here today. We're going to basically go over constructive response items and talk you through the rubric, just like you've been talking to kids, but we're going to give you some examples of how to get anchor papers and then use those anchor papers to talk to the kids about how to improve their scores on the rubric.
I think you're all familiar with the rubric, the 0, the 1, the 2 coefficient, and so on. But I kind of simplify those just in a real quick nutshell to make it easy to look at. So we're looking through this at the 0. If the paper is inaccurate, incomplete, or is missing, we go with the 0. If it fulfills some of the requirements, it's text-based and relevant to the task, then you go with the 1. And if it's all there, obviously you'll go with the 2. So we want to make sure that there are enough details. And usually what I'm finding too, as we go through this, almost always it will say details, plural. All the papers I looked at last night had one detail. So that's something we definitely want to stress with students, that one detail is not going to be enough. If they say details, we need to have 2 or more.
And here's the rubric right up here. This is my first time the iPad up here, so I'm sorry if I make you a little bit dizzy today with expanding and making you go back down. But that's just what Carolee pointed out. So you guys all have copies of this rubric that you've been using with the kids. It's pretty general. It either fulfills it or somewhat fulfills it or doesn't. And so we'll be talking about actual writing samples today. So the first thing I have is a student sample. Let me get back to it. And what I did here, somebody actually gave me this idea to just take a picture of the student's writing and then project it out there. So this is a really nice way to be able to use student examples in a test. This is a 6th grade constructive response from the ISET packet that we gave you. And same question, which animal appeals most to the speaker? And level two is still missing, and it asks for details. So I would give this one a one. That second sentence, the bulldog because in the poem, that could be written better so we can work on the writing as well. But in terms of the content and how many details the student is providing, we've got one.
Do you have any questions or comments as to why that would be the case? Do you agree? Does that make sense?
And then let me give you a three, an example of a three. Oh, yeah, two.
Thank you.
Now, what's key here is it doesn't say how many details to include. And so, the way I looked at this one, I know you're not looking at the actual text, but the actual text had so much information in it. And this question is very open-ended. So, the way I would guide students on this one, is I would say, when it just says explain, write as much as you can. Pull out as much as you can from the text, and you're going to be okay. The more you can pull out, the better. If it says two details, that's fine if they get two. But if it's open-ended, I would just always encourage them. And I hear you say to kids, fill up the lines, fill up the lines. So, true.
And then let me give you a question about that. That one. They use a pronoun, he. Are they going to be counted off because they didn't use pose name or not? Is that important?
It's always good to follow those protocols where you address the pronouns after you use the name. I would remind them of that. It certainly wouldn't hurt for them to do it after.
Okay, and then this is the last response. I know this one was a little hard to read because of the lighting. This is true for Edgar because he had a difficult childhood. His mom passed, his dad abandoned him, and his sister abandoned him. Him and his sister separated, and Edgar went to a foster home. So, since he went through these troubles, and he had to write about it, he could think back to when he had his troubles in life. And
this is a two, because the student is restating two details, actually more than two details, and then at the end, the student wraps it up, and this kind of follows that MAM acronym that we talked about last week. So, this one's pretty strong. There's some language set structure issues, but for the most part, pretty strong. Do you have any questions about these? Anyone disagree? Okay, and it is somewhat subjective. So when you look at, when you meet in your teams, if you're talking about different papers, and even today we're going to talk about some of them, you might disagree a little bit. And in the classroom, the kids might disagree with even the stock answer, the teacher's key. I know someone was telling me that the class had a big discussion because they disagreed with the answer key. All those are good discussion topics, though. So that means the kids are and just take it back to that question. Are they answering the question, and then are they providing the details? You want to do something for me?
Yes.
Okay, how many of you have been able to do this? Do you have things you don't want to find here?
What's the family picture?
What is that? I don't know.
It's all
Oh, okay.
They should be right at the end.
Okay, I have to read the picture.
I looked at the 8th grade papers last night, and the first paper that I'm going to show you is a zero. And it's similar to the one that Misty just showed you. If you noticed on the one that she showed you, there was a lot of writing there. And as we've been told, that length does make a difference. That doesn't mean that it's always going to be accurate. So when you look at mine and you see that I gave you zero, I'd like you to think about that and tell me why I did that. And take a look at that rubric again so you know three things that I just mentioned early on, the summary of it. You would give it a zero if it's basically what's wrong with that. It's just simply not there. Is it complete? Is it accurate? Or is it missing? So we'll take a look at it. Question on mine is a little bit difficult. Misty and I had looked at it also, and she had thought earlier when she looked at it, it's a rather difficult question for eighth graders. I'll read that to you while she brings that up. What descriptions and techniques does the author use to make this article more interesting for the reader? Support your answer with details from the article. And again, we hear that word details, which is plural form. The author gives you a short story at first to drag you in, and as you read on, they give you some details that had an option of being there.
This one will be weird, but I can take a picture of it.
Okay.
I have a picture of it.
I can't.
Okay.
But what do you think when you hear that? What runs through your mind as you listen to that kind of answer?
There's not specific details.
There's no specific details, and they're smart enough to know that details are important, so they come back and say, they give some details, but they don't tell us what they are. Good catch. Anything else that comes across your mind?
They're just filling in the space.
Exactly, they're filling in the space. We've all heard the term, they say a whole lot of nothing. I felt that way when I read through this one. That there is some writing there, there's some thought process, but there really is a whole lot of nothing. They don't come back with any description, they don't come back with any techniques, there's no supporting why it was interesting. So we'll take a look at one that I gave a 1-2, and you know the question, they're looking for descriptions and techniques that make it more interesting. The techniques and description the author uses to make the article more unique and interesting is by explaining how his feelings towards the mummies. The author says the eyes of some gaze at me. And here's my opening sentence again. The techniques and description the author uses to make the article more unique and interesting is by explaining how his feelings are towards the mummies. What do you think of the opening sentence? What's good about it? It's restating. It is making it clear. It's only sense to go back and restate. Do you see one detail in there? Why it's interesting? Something that it does for you as a reader? What did he address on those senses? You know, the 5 senses we talk about, the smell and the feel and all this. What does he say about that? Does it make him feel like he's there? And then he gives that detail about the author says the eyes of some gazed at me. So he gives you that visual sense of, I was there, I can feel it. So this one I gave a 1, but again, what is missing? What kind of this page are from being a going from a 1 to a 2? One detail. Thank you very much. One detail. Have they added one more detail? I believe this paper would qualify. And as I read through the 8-page paper on this particular question only, I didn't look at all the rest of it, but I could not honestly say I would have given a 2 to any of the responses to this question. And as Misty and I thought earlier, it was a more difficult question, so there are probably some 2s on the others. But we have another paper who is an example that was, again, on the mark but not quite there. The descriptions and techniques the author uses to make the article interesting is that he explains more about how the Roman people of Egypt kind of changed the people's style. Like the article says, but the red pearls on the crowned mummy are a Roman hairstyle, a sign that Rome had also touched their lives. What about the opening sentence? Is it clear? Do we know what they're going to talk about? Yes, it is. It is clear. It says a description of the techniques, and it even goes to the level of saying those descriptions that are used to make the article interesting. So it's a good restated sentence. It's a good opening sentence. And it explains how the Roman rule over Egypt kind of changed people's lifestyle. So they picked up on a good detail that when the Romans came in, life changed with Egyptians. And then he goes on to talk about the red pearls. So you would see a detail there. But again, what would be missing in that paper? What makes you think I stop at the 1 and not do that at 2? The details are a little bit, there really aren't the 2 details. I didn't feel like,
but if I step right over and I create this on the line, so everything we wrote.
That is a very good question. Peggy Orchard, when she talked to her on next Tuesday, she's going to come to each grade level meeting, related arts meeting, or talk about all those little ISIP details. I don't think that's the case anymore, but I want to double check that. Very good point. And this one I wavered on. Some of you might say it's a 2. You could look at it and say that the Roman rule changed their lifestyle. That could be one reason why. You could look at that in detail, and the art instead of the red pearls. So they gave a specific there. it's right there. This was, to me, was the best paper out of the two. I mean, out of the papers that I read. But hopefully that gives you a little bit more insight on what you're looking for and how she grades papers. Do you have any questions? And Crystal, that's a great question. I'll never forget to find out the answer on that one for sure. Because if that makes all the difference in the world, we definitely want to pick up those points.
And then as far as the, just this tool with the mirroring, it's pretty cool that you can project what's on the iPad. You'll probably want to make sure that all your stuff is showing, because you can see on my thing right now. So when you do it for the kids, it's probably on the iPad, you can, you know, but we don't miss something. As far as what we want, where we want to go now, we asked you to bring some of your constructive responses, and the homeroom teachers have been doing I-STEP prompts. And so related arts, you know that for the most part, and take a look at some of the constructive response items, just to have practice having dialogue. And I know I've been hearing so many people talking that they're doing this in grade level meetings already, or you know, a math and a language arts teacher are getting together to just discuss the responses. So that's good. The more dialogue we can have, because even between language arts teachers, there's always that subjectivity. So we want to try to make sure that we're on the same page. So right now, if you could just group up whoever does have
So we're good to go, we know what we're doing. We get into the little, so go ahead and group up.